are familiar with the work that Sprite does. They do these really incredible landing pages. I remember this mesh grid event like blew up Twitter when it first came out. All of their landing pages have little details, like they have conversations with real DOM nodes, like they're actually editing text nodes there. 3D elements, like globes, polygon globes, and they're not even videos, like they respond to scroll positions, so they're being live rendered. Sprite does all this amazing work. And when you log into Sprite, right, so you click the little dashboard in the corner, you're taken to a different world. You're taken to the dashboard. And there's no mesh gradient, there's no 3D globes. There probably shouldn't be, that's pretty clear, that's not a bad thing. But it's clear that this is like a different product created by a different team to serve a different purpose. If we look at it, we see that like the Sprite dashboard is built using React. And if we go back to the landing pages, we see that they are not built using React. I don't think that surprises many people. Like, we kind of think of React as a tool for dashboards and software as a service. We think of React as a tool for building dashboards, software as a service. And it's my opinion that like you don't need React to build a landing page like this. Like clearly the Sprite team has made that obvious. But there's actually some interesting advantages to using tools like React, using any sort of JavaScript framework. This talk is called The Whimsical Potential of JavaScript Framework. And I want to share my experience using React to build tools, to build things that I think are pretty whimsical and fun. This is also my first conference talk since 2019, so I'm really honored to be here. Surprisingly nervous, but I think usually once I get going with it, it all works out just fine. So I have a blog. I blog at joshwpromo.com. Internet, I do. Where is my? There it is. I don't actually feel that nervous, but I get this weird thing where I can't really breathe correctly. But, so I apologize if my breathing's a little strange. The fun thing about having a blog is you can kind of treat it as your own little playpen. So if I have a fun idea for something, I'll go ahead and implement it. Like I was inspired by, you know, when you're a kid and you have those iron shavings and you have a magnet underneath and it turns those little ripples in it. That was the inspiration behind this idea. It's like a set of lines that move based on the cursor. I also had a lot of fun with this icon up here, my dark light toggle. Now that I know that you can use trigonometry functions in CSS, I could have done it without JavaScript at all, which is maybe something I'll use after. Yeah, Una's talk is amazing. There's so many things that I've had like one eye on, and now it's like, oh shoot, I should start using that. That's really cool. The thing I want to talk about is my blog post has this like button. It's way in over there. And there's a bunch of little things that it does. Like it rotates based on the cursor position. The eyes, like it's kind of hard to see, but the eyes move independently of the head. It's a like button, and so it likes to be liked, and if you move the cursor away, it gets sad. But you can click on it. I also have sound if you want to hear the little sound effect. Keep going. It pops up some pretty. A little pro tip that people don't realize, you can right-click to take it away. And he doesn't like that either. The nice thing, though, is that he's very upbeat and optimistic. He never stays sad for too long. Give him a second. Maybe it's that I have to move away first. He should cheer up. Come on, buddy. There he goes. Good. So this is what I want to look at. I want to look at how to build something like that. We're going to build an A. And I was really sort of hoping that by the time I got here, I would have a reason why it's an egg. Really, I chose an egg because it's a simpler shape to make, because there's less complexity. Maybe we can pretend that it's like, I don't know, some cartoon character. Like, remember in Garfield, there was Garfield and Friends. You had the Friends, and there was that little egg shell with the feet. Maybe we can pretend that it's that. If we think about how to build it, first we need an asset. And so in Figma, it turns out it's really easy to make an egg. You draw a circle. Then you go into the like point editing mode, and you grab the top point and pull it up. Hey! So that's what I did. And then, you know, I created, I grabbed an ellipse, and made a black circle. I'm not going to do the whole thing. I think you get sort of the idea, right? One thing that I learned recently, which is kind of cool, I used to have to like go to export this and then choose an SVG and do all that. You can right click and copy it as a SVG, which is very, very cool. So we have an SVG now, that's good. How do we do this effect? And the thing I want to focus on is the rotation of the head and the position of the eye. Right? Those are the two things we're going to reproduce. Well, I need to know where the cursor is within the viewport, and I need to know where the egg is, like where this bounding box, like this rectangle that represents this offset. And if I know where those two things are, it's a matter of like doing the relative math of just, okay, so the cursor to the left of the egg, then the eye has to go that way, then I have to rotate this way. Here's part of what that looks like in vanilla JavaScript. I'm setting up an event listener on the window so that when I move the mouse, we run this function. I find that client X is kind of an awkward, I never remember that, so I put it in my own little mouse position object. Then I need to find the SVG, and so I use document.query selector, I look it up, and then I need to know where it is, so I call elements like the bounding client rect. And I know this method is a bit of a mouthful, but it's super, super handy. It tells me exactly where this element is, by giving me the distance from the left edge of the viewport to the left edge of the element, and the same thing from the top. Come on, change that to that distance. And then it also tells you the current width and height as calculated. It does this after all of the different like CSS is going to apply. So if you translate something, it's after all that stuff, which is really cool. Now that I have those two pieces of information, right, I know where the mouse is, I know where the element is, and what its bounding box is, I can pass those into this function, calculate head rotation. I decided not to go into, like, we're going to treat this as a bit of a black box, because I didn't want to have to spend 10 minutes explaining the trigonometry. I thought that would be too much of a tangent. Yes, a little trigonometry joke. So we're going to treat it as a black box, and just assume that we give it those two pieces of information, and it gives us the rotation in degrees, and then we can apply that as a transform. Anyone see the problem? Or not the problem, but like any issues with this? If you see anything, you can shout it out. I don't mind. Maybe that's an unfair request. It's not so much a problem, but mouse events fire really, really, really quickly. Right? Like you're moving the mouse, and it can be 60 times a second more, I guess, if you're on a higher display or a higher refresh rate monitor. This line right over here is kind of slow. Like, I never tried a test on this computer because it's not quite representative. So I went to the computer store where I live, and I said, like, give me the cheapest computer you have. The cheapest Windows computer. And so they gave me, it was $150 Canadian, which I think is like $20 US, something like that. It's like $120. And so, you know, it's a new Windows laptop, it's an Intel Celeron, and it does not run well. And on this computer, this method takes between half a millisecond and like 3 or 4 milliseconds. Which doesn't sound like a lot, but when you have a mouse move event running 60 times a second, you only have like 16 milliseconds to do all the work you need, and a bunch of that's going to be taken up by the actual transform. So it's too much work, too slow. What we can do, is we can lift that work up so that I'm only doing that work. I don't know why I keep like trying to, if you can look at my screen. Why do we keep trying, like, if we lift this work up, when we first like load the page or run this code, we do the work then. And that way, as I'm moving the mouse and as these events are firing really often, we don't wind up repeating that work. And this works well, but there's a new problem now. The new problem now is that the element's bounding box can change. So like, for example, as I scroll the page, we're moving where this element is on the page. If I resize the window, or if I resize the element itself. So, we have like a bunch more work we can do. This is like the thing, right? You have a cute working prototype that works really well on your machine, and then you have to go on this journey to get it ready for production, where you have to add an event listener for when you scroll, or when you resize the window, we can use the resize observer. And I should have probably used the mutation observer, so I forgot that existed. All of this work, and this isn't even fixed. Really what we need to do as well is debounce the scroll handling, because scroll events happen really often as well. We don't want to be recalculating the bounding box on every single scroll if the scroll is happening really, really often. And we also have to remember to clean this stuff up. So we have to remove the event listeners when we're done with them. This is where I start to think a tool like React can come in handy. And I'm using React, by the way, because it's the tool that I'm familiar with, but I think any JavaScript framework will work equally well. So, let's talk about how to do this. Using React. So, I have my same age character, has the same animation. And by the way, I'm going to finish this talk, or rather, I'm not going to assume any React experience. At the same time, we're talking about some pretty advanced stuff. So the way that I'm going to square that is I'm going to keep things really high level and explain things sort of conceptually, but a lot of, like, detail is going to be lost. Ultimately, my goal here today, which I guess I should have said earlier, is not to convince anybody that, like, React is the best tool for any job, just that I find it really useful in my own work, and I want to kind of show some of why that is. So, I have a like button component, and if I scroll down, I see that I'm returning something that looks like HTML. It's not HTML, but JSX. And the way that I describe JSX is it's a description of the UI that I want. So I have, essentially, I'm telling React, hey, I need a button. That button has some sort of class name. It can contain an SVG. That SVG has a bunch of attributes. And React says, okay. And it generates the actual DOM for this description. But unlike a template, unlike something with like JADE or PUG or PHP or EJS or whatever else, it's a live description. And so if this gets changes, then React will do the work to actually update the DOM. Yeah, so if I roll back up, I have this first line over here. And this is our first little bit of like interactivity where I'm saying const mount position is equal to use mount position. If I go into this code, I see that I'm creating a state variable. And the way that I like to explain state variable is that I am effectively telling React, hey, this variable is important. When this variable changes, it probably affects the UI, so you're going to have to recalculate that UI. And so I'm doing the work of creating the state variable, and then binding it to the window, with window.addEventListener, and then, importantly, I'm doing the cleanup, so that when this component unmounts, we are undoing that work. I think it'll be interesting, actually, if I return a paragraph, which includes now, instead of showing the egg, I'm showing the mouse position. I could also say that this is an iframe. So, like, specifically, this is sort of the viewport that we're working with. And what I find so cool about this is that we can see exactly what the realm of possible UI is. I know that I have a paragraph. I know that it has three children, right? It has whatever this variable is. Then it has a text node, which is a comma and a space. And then it has some other variable. I know that, like, there's never going to be 17 images inside this paragraph. Unless you really like things that the variable is. And similarly, like if I get rid of this bit of work, I know that I'm going to have a button that includes an SVG. And there's no way for me to change that from outside that, like from outside this component. So yeah, I get the mouse position. I get the bounding box. I have this other function which does all the work we talked about and then a little bit more. Like it waits a little bit, it lets the layout settle before calculating the initial value. The thing that's really cool about this to me, and the thing that I hope is coming across, because I don't know how obvious it is, in plain JavaScript, we can write a function that'll tell me, like, where is this element on the screen right now? This one line of code, and I guess we also need to get a reference to this, but these two lines of code, don't just tell me where it is now, they tell me where it is at every moment in time. And so as I'm moving the mouse, that bounding box is being recalculated, or really, the mouse position is being recalculated when I move the mouse. The bounding box is going to be calculated when I resize the window, or when the element itself gets resized because there's not quite enough space for it. And so whenever these things change, we wind up updating the UI, rerunning these calculations, which again, a bit of a black box. And then we create these style objects, which are applied to the nodes themselves. But if something that bothers me about this, and maybe you've noticed it as well, if I keep the motion really sort of smooth, and towards the perimeter, it looks all right. But if I sort of move aggressively, then the motion's kind of like herky-jerky. Like it doesn't quite feel super smooth and organic. And at first I thought, okay, we can solve this with CSS. Like let me, and by the way, I should point out that there's all this like raw, confusing markup in here. I didn't actually write this. This was all what I got from Figma. That's also CSCG. I'm not that good with CSCG. if I apply a CSS tag. So I'll grab the SVG as well as the group element within, and I'll set transition, transform. And then how long do we wait? Like maybe 200 milliseconds? If I try this, it doesn't really work super well. Maybe that's because the transform is the wrong time. I make it quicker. Like, it kind of works, but it doesn't really feel very nice. And I have yet to find like a value that feels nice. And I think the reason for that is that CSS transitions aren't meant to be interrupted. Like, we're doing something kind of weird here, which is I'm applying a CSS transform in JavaScript, and I'm updating it super, super quickly. And CSS transitions just aren't really meant to deal with that. So, instead, we're going to use library. We're going to import useSpring and animate it from the React package. Essentially, what I want to do is I have these objects, right? And I want to, like, let's say the mouse goes from here to here. The rotation goes from, like, minus 10 degrees to plus 20 degrees. I don't want to do that quick of a transition. Like, I want to go minus 10, minus 9, minus 7, minus 1. Right? Like, get some smooth interpolation going with that. So, I'm going to call useSpring, and I'm going to pass it that object. Now, when I do this, I will have effectively ruined everything. Like, I will have disabled the animation. And that's because before, I had a plain JavaScript object where I was getting transform to a CSS string, and I was handing that object along to an SVG. Whereas now, useSpring returns, I think they call it like an interpolated object. It's like some wrapped version of a thing that plain DOM nodes don't understand. So I have to do a little bit more work to unpack it. And the way that I do that is I render an animated SVG, right? I'm grabbing this animated thing that I imported, and I'm updating the tag so that I'm getting an animated SVG. I'll do the same thing for the group. So it's an animated dot group. And now I can check it out. I can be as abrupt with my cursor as I want. And not only does it work a lot better, it just, we get the benefit of spring physics. And this is like we were talking about with gravity. Physics that are based in the real world tend to feel a lot more fluid and organic. And my goodness, I just really like the way this feels. We can also configure this. So I can say, like, maybe I want the eyes to move a little bit quicker, so I'll add a config of. And then this is where it gets kind of weird too. It's spring physics, and so rather than having an even curve and a duration, we model the actual spring. So stiffness is like, imagine you have a spring, and you pull it apart, and you let go. If it's really like tightly coiled, it's going to like slam back really quickly. Whereas if it's like really thin and loosely coiled, it's going to be a lot more lethargic. So for this, I want to have a pretty high value, let's say 500. And then friction is the other parameter, and it's like, it's kind of like metaphysical almost. It's like, what universe are you in, and how much friction is in that universe? If you're in a vacuum, and I said zero friction, then you see that, like, they're just going to keep going. That's probably not what I want. Let's do, like, 20. And so now you see the eyes are a little bit quicker than the body. Maybe I'll do like a much more like molasses-like configuration. So I'll say 150, so less dip and more friction. And now we see that like there's this really nice sort of balance between the two elements. By the way, you might be looking at this and thinking like, what monstrosity have I done? Am I making up HTML tags here? Fortunately, all of this kind of gets dealt with at the JavaScript layer. And so if I look at what I'm actually rendering, let's add some space for this. I'm rendering a plain SVG. And essentially that animated wrapper allows me to, like I was saying, interpolate over the transform value. And so now check it out. Like if I move the cursor, I can keep your eye on this like the value over here. Even better, the much more quickly updating value over here, we see it doing that work of giving me a bunch of really, really smooth, like lots of decimal places, so you know it must be very accurate. Very, very smooth motion. So I was working on this, and I thought, like, this is kind of cool. But I'm not an artist. Like, this doesn't really look like an egg. What if I could do this with, like, a real 3D model? And so I opened Blender, I created a model of an egg, and then I used a library called React 3 Fiber. This is a wrapper around 3JS, and it allows you to use WebGL to render a real 3D object. And so we had the same effect, but now it's legitimately, like, a 3D egg. And the thing that's really cool about this to me is that not that much code actually has changed. I do have, so now I'm using this use loader, which again I get from the library from React Reviver, which loads up my 3D egg. But this code is exactly the same. Like I'm using the exact same code, the exact same custom hook that I created to track the user's mouse position. I'm using the exact same code to give me the bounding box. For the calculation, the black boxes I keep not talking about, it's the same thing. I just have to, like, if there's a bit of a different scale, and I had to switch radians to degrees. So there were, like, some small tweaks, but fundamentally, it's the same logic. And even this stuff, like, I'm still using uSpring. I'm still using React Spring, because without it, if I get rid of this, it still works, but it feels too abrupt to me, right? It's tracking the cursor a little bit too closely. So I use the exact same library with the exact same API, because now instead of putting a CSS transform, I'm rotating a 3D object, which I just think is so cool. In terms of the actual UI that I'm returning, this part, I admit, is very different because it's a whole different environment. Pandas I get from the library, and it does two things. It creates an HTML5 canvas that uses WebGL, but it also creates a new React rendering context. And what that means is that instead of passing DOM primitives, like buttons and divs and frames, we pass 3D primitives, like lights and cameras and meshes and geometries. And so we see I have this animated group, which is my model itself, and I have it broken into three separate pieces. So if I get rid of the mouse, now it has much less, I mean, it looks kind of scared, seriously. Then I have my camera, and I can, like, zoom way in if you want and get very up close. What we notice is that there's, like, a bunch of light being reflected in the eye. That's because I have this environment, and I can change that from, like, a warehouse to a forest. This is all, like, a ton sort of width. And now you see I might probably zoom out a little bit. It just sort of sets the environment that your 3D model is being rendered within. If I get rid of it entirely, then we see that I have this one very kind of stark light. And I like if I set this to 0, so I move it to be right overhead, and then I move it to be right underneath, it's like a spooky story time. That is fun. The thing that I find really remarkable about this, though, is that I haven't written that much code. Like, to do the animation, I have uSpring. I don't know if anyone's used VGA, but it is not quite this minimal. Like, there's usually a lot more to it. And I think the reason we can get away with it is that React sort of acts as a centralized thread that we can hang things on. Like, we can say, okay, I know that I have to do a bunch of setup work in terms of my listening for events and debouncing and resize observers. I can give that chunk of work to React and say, do this when you need to set it up. I can give it a different chunk of work and say, do this when you need to tear it down. I only have to write this code once. And now, whenever I need to know where an element is, I can very quickly load in, you know, write this one line of code, and React will tell me not only where the element is now, but where it is at any moment in time. I kind of like electronic music. This is not my, one day I hope to have a gear collection like this. But the thing about music, especially like electronic music hardware, is that you tend to accumulate a lot of it. Like, you have all these independent devices, and they're all their own actor. Like, they're all musicians in a symphony. And, you know, you can play them individually. If you press one of these keys, it'll make a noise. But what you want is to have them all synchronized. So you can, like, press space on your computer, and the synth starts, the bass line starts, the drum machines go, the effects work, the guitar pedals, all that stuff works together. This is the role that I sort of see React doing, where React is the conductor of your application, and it provides all of the timing, the life cycle, all the stuff you need to hook all of these different pieces together. One more water break. I want to talk about one more thing, which is a blog post I wrote called An Interactive Guide to Flexbox. This layout, by the way, shout out to Adam, who I think is here somewhere. Yeah, right there. He built this really cool layout in Flexbox that goes through these four different UIs in, without media queries. So it's all just sort of taking advantage of the Flexbox algorithm. And I thought it was so cool. And I thought I should write a blog post that explains all the different properties for how that works. So first, we start by just looking at the layout mode. So this is what happens when you have four children in flow layout. We flip the parent to display Flex, and now they sort of morph between those two layouts. I have another unit that shows how Flex direction can change, how things work. I have something like 24 of these demo units on this page. And I'll go through a couple more because they're cool. Just showing how we can align items along the primary axis, how we can align them along the cross axis. And I think it's just so fun to see how these properties flip between rows and columns. 24 of them, like quite a lot of them. And I don't think I need React to build this. In fact, I'm pretty confident I could build any one of these units without React. But the thing that React gives me is the ability to compartmentalize all of the things that make this challenging. I don't know if I could have 24 of them, or at least it would take me longer to be able to build 24 of them. I want to hop into the code for this a little bit. So, the blog post itself, let me make this bigger. The blog post itself is written in MDX, and MDX is friggin' amazing. I wish I had more time to talk about it. The idea is it's Markdown, but within Markdown, I have the ability to embed my own React components, my own elements. So I have this mobile-only component that means that everything inside here will only be shown on mobile devices. And then I have these Flex Demos, so I have Flex Demo Layout Mode. If I look at the Flex Demo component, it's a thin wrapper around Demo, which is itself something I should probably mention. This is the right blog post. No, this is it. I really like visualizing things, and so a long time ago, I don't think it was even for this blog post that I used it here, I created a demo unit. And essentially, I have a cell. The cell gives me this dark background and a bunch of different controls. So I have a slider control, and then I have a radio button control. Here we're showing how shadows provide the illusion of depth, right? Like the shadow makes the element feel higher up and further away. And this is just my hacky, like, I picked a lot of stuff here to make it look like this, but I wanted to show how that works. I have this demo unit that allows me to reuse this framing, this shell. And then the flex demo is a thin wrapper around that. And then if I look, for example, for layout mode, we see that there's very little code required for this, but I have some variables. I have display being set to block. I can change that display from block to flex. And then I pass that state onto this output component. I think I can look at that. Where is output? There it is. It takes a bunch of those things and applies it to these elements. And we're starting to get things that feel kind of complicated here, but because I'm able to compartmentalize them, because I'm able to tuck them away into their own little components, and because I'm relying on React to deal with all the things that it deals with on my behalf, I feel like I can reach further. I can build things that are beyond what I would otherwise be able to build, because I have this tool sort of helping me sweep things under the rug and reuse things that would otherwise, when I try to do stuff like this without React, and maybe this is just a reflection on me, but I would find myself writing code that intersects itself, and I'd want to put a bird nest where every additional thing that I do makes the whole thing feel more like a house of cards that's about to fall over. React, I find really helpful. React is shorthand again for any JavaScript framework. They help me manage that, and I think it is really useful for this kind of work because of that. So there's someone who wrote a blog post a few years ago called The Great Divide. Anyone read this blog post? Okay, not as many as I thought. Good, I will summarize. The thesis behind this blog post is that the term front-end developer has sort of evolved to refer to two entirely separate people. You have people on the front of the front-end, who are people who really care about semantic HTML, robust CSS, just dealing with user experience things, maybe a bit of JavaScript. I think people in this camp generally see JavaScript as a way to, sprinkle in additional bits of functionality, whether that's something critical for accessibility or some sort of sprinkles. Then on the other side, you have the back of the front end. And these are people who rely on the JavaScript framework. They know a lot about the build tooling, like Webpack and Babel. They don't know as much about HTML and CSS. And somehow, we've all had the same job title. And we all sort of do the same thing. Ultimately, we're all building user interfaces, but the day-to-day work looks very different. I find this, undeniably a true framing. When I think about my own work and the companies I've worked in and the skill sets I've seen people have, we do sort of bucket ourselves into these two camps. But for me, I care about both of these things. And so I sort of feel like I'm straddling, like, the Grand Canyon and slowly tearing my hamstring, trying to get it all, hold it all together. It's the kind of thing where I think that there's a lot of value to both of these skill sets, and certainly I think people in either camp, I mean, really, let me be more frank, people in the front of the front end, this is enough to be a full job, and you shouldn't have to learn any of this other stuff if you don't want to. But for myself, I find focusing on this stuff allows me to deliver the kinds of user experiences I have in my head, and can really be useful for that. It's funny, I left my job a couple of years ago to focus on developer education, so I started creating online courses. And it wasn't obvious to me at the time, but I've sort of been unconsciously working to bridge this divide. Like, the first course that I created was called CSS for JavaScript Developers, and I'm sort of bringing this front of the front end skill to people who consider themselves JavaScript developers, people who work in the back of the front end. For the past couple of years, I've been working, or last year or so, I've been working on a course called The Joy of React, which is sort of the opposite. Like, I'm bringing the React skill set to people who are comfortable with CSS, HTML, and a bit of JavaScript, but don't yet feel very comfortable with React. So it is kind of like I've sort of stumbled into this role of trying to bring the valuable parts to either side. But now, I have a link that I will share. You can see the code that I'm using to talk, and that's what I have. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Josh. Would you like to join me for the
Let's do it.
Oh, wonderful. Have you had a lot of eggs all over? Like, on all the different, like, on flies, on...
A lot of different what?
Eggs.
Eggs.
Sorry. All right. Well,
like I said, I was hoping to find a reason for that, but...
That's something sensitive. Was there a few interesting questions that came in indeed as well? For example, one thing that came up relatively quickly in the beginning of the conversation, of the talk, how do you stage the animations and plan them out? Do you have, like, a plan about what you want to achieve, or is it more like a feeling?
It's interesting. I generally have an idea in my mind of how I want something to work. But I'd say, like, more often than not, that idea changes. Because as I start experimenting, it prompts new ideas. And it's like, especially, like, the most serendipitous thing is when you get a bug that gives you an idea. Like, I was trying to have it do one thing, and it winds up doing a different thing, but I actually kind of like that thing, so let's keep that thing. That's always nice when that happens. So, yeah, usually if I have an idea in my head, and, like, I'm trying to realize that thing.
But then how does it come to debugging it? Like, when you feel like, oh, this is not quite what I want, how does debugging actually happen? Is it, again, more like a feeling where you just play and experiment and you adjust the way you see in there? Or do you have, like, a framework or something that knows it for your courses?
It's one of those things where I've never really had, like, you know, I do my own design work. And so I've never really, I do my own design work despite not considering myself a designer and not having any design skills, really. At least not, like, the formal skills that designers actually have. So I never really had, like, great tools for this stuff. I've always just kind of debugged in the browser. So you write some CSS, you write some JavaScript, you run it, you see what happens, you open the developer tools, you tinker with it, and you sort of just, like, tinkle away at it until it does either what you like or what you want, or you come up with something new that actually works better. But it's true, like, there are tools, right? Like, there's, what's the problem? If the code lets you, like, build something in After Effects and export it to the web, you know what I'm talking about? Lying, yes. And I've just never learned how, it's cool, but I've never learned how to do it, so I've always just seen it in browser.
One person asking, what do you think about the usage of WebAssembly for implementing whimsical animations and whimsical?
It's a really, like, it's an idea I haven't really explored, but it's really interesting. Like, I do think, especially with, like, for the 3D stuff, right, like, there's a lot we can do if, like, performance wasn't an issue. Like, there are games in JavaScript, but there's the issue of the garbage collector, right? You have this garbage collector that's going to run at some point. Like, I want to make a rhythm game. I think that would be fun. But I don't trust the JavaScript garbage collector. And so if we could write in some lower-level language where we manage the garbage collector ourselves, it would unlock a lot of doors. In terms of, like, whether I think, like, I don't necessarily see it having a major impact on the day-to-day work of most developers, because I feel like it's, we already have enough stuff to know, and it's another big thing to know. But certainly, I think, like, for building interesting, novel things like games or really unique user experiences, that could be something really, really cool.
Mm-hmm. Talking about performance, we also had another question that came in. But this is orchestration of the JavaScript events in React. You're still subject to an exhaustive number of operations per event loop. Is there performance or any other benefit from doing so using React?
It's a great question. It's true, right? If you have a state variable, that means that React is going to re-render whenever that state variable changes. So in my example, whenever I move the mouse, that means I'm re-rendering, and there isn't a cost associated with React doing its reconciliation. That cost has gotten really low, and so it depends, right? It depends how much stuff, because the way React works is it generates a sketch, you change something, it generates a new sketch, and it compares the two and tries to find the differences gained. And says, okay, you changed this paragraph, needs to have this text node be edited. The editing of the paragraph is as quick as it would be, but you have to figure out based on these sketches what you have to edit. If it's only a paragraph with a couple of numbers, or like my button with the SVG, that's not really a ton of work, and so it tends to happen pretty quickly. Again, I did that testing on the Windows laptop and found it works just fine. React Spring, however, has higher standards than I do. And so when you use React Spring, assuming you like, configure it correctly, you actually avoid the React render loop. And so if you change a value, and the example I said wasn't the best example because I was changing the mouse often, I suppose I throttle that so that the mouse is only being updated every 200 milliseconds or whatever. React Spring would update every 16 milliseconds outside of React, and so it kind of circumvents that process. So there are ways to account for it. In my experience, it hasn't really been necessary most of the time. Like, the cost of using React is low enough that it, and again, like, I'm speaking very generally here because there are certainly cases where it matters a lot. But in general, it doesn't really limit what I want to do most of the time.
Right. It looks like somebody who was really curious about what's the result then with the $120 laptop in the end. What was the
latency
waiting, I guess, until this is.
You know, it's funny. And I did the same thing where I bought, at the time, what was the most popular budget smartphone in India. It was the Xiaomi Redmi 6A, I think. And it was $30 on AliExpress kind of thing, very, maybe not that cheap. I forget exactly. Cheaper than any phone that you could buy at a store in North America. And the thing I expected and what I got, and same thing with the laptop, were wildly different. The worst experiences were things like news websites, because of all the like bloatware that's included, calling the React applications, like Twitter, Airbnb, they're surprisingly fine. Like they work really, really well. Actually, my own blog, which I've tested extensively, as you might imagine, works better than I would expect, and better than your like a typical website you would find. But there are just so many like little annoyances with using my budget laptop. Like just opening any Chrome window takes quite a while. I found that a lot of CSS transitions work flawlessly. Like, even if you do pretty advanced things with lots of orchestration, I'm trying to remember what example was, because I ran into this recently for an upcoming blog post where I was changing a lot and I was worried about it and I was sprinkling, will change, the property that like MDN will warn you, like, use this sparingly, it uses a lot of memory. I was using it on like dozens of elements and it was fine, like on both the Windows laptop and my budget Android smartphone. So I think that like the browser has become really, really effective, and the thing that I really noticed is all the third-party tracking scripts. That's what really kind of kills the experience.
Mm-hmm. We also have a question that came up about web components. What are the things around them, and are there suitable alternatives to React componentization?
I wish I was equipped to answer this question, but I really haven't experimented with them much. The thing that I hear is that like if you use a framework around them like Lit, I forget things about Lit, that they're a perfectly reasonable alternative. For me, it was more that, you know, I discovered React in 2015, 2016, something like that, and it's what we used to work, and so it's the rabbit hole that I've found myself going down. But I always want to be careful that, like, I don't want to come across as a React advocate. I think there's lots of really great tools out there, and it's just the one that I happen to use. I think that web components, and I always like the idea of using the platform, so it's really cool that there is a native way to deal with new components now. It's something that I should really spend more time with.
Right. Every time we have a conversation about animations, very often you would hear questions around accessibility coming into play. If somebody prefers to use motion, do we just turn off animations? Do we change animations? Do we have different layers of animations? How does it all work? And one question that came up here, is it possible, in your opinion, to make Wind accessible, or should it simply be disabled, keep for users for whom it wouldn't work well?
Yeah, that's a good question. certainly reduced motion is a very important part of everything I do. I try frequently to either emulate that in the browser settings or actually enable it for myself and make sure that no motion is too aggressive. I'm not an expert, so everything I say should be taken. This is generally true, with a grain of salt. But my understanding is that the reason that the preferred motion preference exists is primarily for people with vestibular disorders, which are kind of inner ear imbalances where, like, parallax motion, big sweeping changes can trigger nausea, dizziness, other things. Of course, so many accessibility features are intended to solve accessibility problems, but then find a larger audience amongst people who just don't like them or don't want them. My take with this has been anything that moves should be disabled. If something fades in and fades out or changes color, I don't think that's a problem, so I leave that stuff in. And often that's what I'll do. If something moves in from the top of the screen, I'll add a media query for preferred reduced motion and have it fade in instead. That way there's still a little bit of a transition because it can be jarring for things to suddenly appear. That's not how things work in the real world. That's been my compromise for this sort of thing. And I think broadly, to answer that question about like whether whimsy should be entirely disabled, there's so much, like, the whimsy category is so huge, right? A 3D illustration that's totally static, like my little React Atom fella that I showed briefly at the end of my talk, I think that's whimsical, and that doesn't require any special effects. So everything that they like, always a place for it. It's just about making sure that we are not unintentionally causing illness or making the experience less pleasant with our whimsical ideas. So that's been my philosophy with it.
Right. One thing that's kind of built up on top of that is, do you keep animations going every time the person reaches the page? Or how do you ensure animation on the screen so it doesn't get annoying beyond the first few times?
Oh, this is such a good question. This is something that I wish people did more of, because this is the argument, right? I come up with some really cool transition, it takes a second and a half, and people say, okay, that's great. The first time, the second time, the third time, the fourth time, by now we're starting to like I've seen this already, I'm a power user, you send, like, I did this demo where you send an email, and the email would fold itself up and shoot itself across the screen. And like, that's fun and all, but at a certain point, you have 7 more emails to send, and these seconds are adding up. But the thing is, like, we have so many solutions to this problem that aren't just, like, disable the whole thing. Like, I feel like there's local storage as one example, right? Figure out how many times the person has seen this thing and disable it after they hit the fourth time, or come up with some quicker version of it. The whole point of whimsy is that it's supposed to be delightful, and, like, having something be unexpected or surprising or novel is part of that. So if you have this animation that's really whimsical, that you show it to them 150 times, I would argue that we've moved outside the realm of whimsy by doing that. So yeah, just like keep track of how many times you've shown something. If you have a user object, if you have a backend, you can hang it on that. That's something I do on my course platform. Or you can have it just be in local storage and say that for this device, limit how many times they see it.
Yeah, that's useful. There's also one question which obviously always comes up when it comes to delightful animations for delightful experiences. I'm just wondering, a lot of the designs we have don't have any whimsical animations, and it's very difficult to bring stakeholders in product and design to invest in animations in the first place. So, when do we need them, when do we not need them?
It is a good question, and this has been the hill that I will die on with every company I've worked in, is advocating for us to not cut the stuff from scope when we start getting near the end of a sprint, and it's the first thing on the chopping block because it's the least essential. And it's the kind of thing where I find that, in general, each individual thing that we do is relatively minor, but there is this, the sum is greater than the whole of its parts, or the whole that thing that people say. It's true, like, any individual effect that I work on isn't going to be make or break, but the sum total of a bunch of them is a whole different experience. It's hard to convince stakeholders of that. Like, it is always a challenge. And it's tricky because I think a lot of design software doesn't account for it. Like, if someone can do a Figma design, there is ways to incorporate motion and whimsy into that, but it's not often used. I think there is prototyping and stuff, but I've never gotten a design that had the animation curve as part of it, for example. The closest I'll come is that at Khan Academy we had a spring. Like, these are the spring configs for the Khan Academy spring, which is cool. Often this kind of falls between the cracks of design and engineering, and I've always seen it as my role to sort of like scoop up that extra bit of work and make sure that it gets included. It's difficult, but I think it's also the angle of like Because this is so universally true, and because there is so little whimsy on the web, it increases the power. Like, if you can be the one, like, let's say you have three competitors, and your product is, like, much more whimsical than theirs, that's like a competitive advantage. At least it can be. If you're making funeral homes, maybe not so much, but depending on the business. Yeah, like, it really is sort of an underutilized edge, I think.
Right. Do you have, like, a particular task of challenge that you want to tackle at some point, or are you making the game already? Like, but is it like something that you see, like, I really want to do this one day? You can only have, let's say, like 3-4 weeks of just doing that. I would love to build it, or design it, or make it happen. Is there something like that?
It's a good question. I don't really have any, like, great examples. I think the 3D stuff, like, I saw that little egg. I'm still very much a novice when it comes to the whole world of 3D, because that's something I want to explore more, because I think it is. The world of WebGL is enormous, and you can do so many really cool things. So it is something I hope to dig more into and come up with more. I've only really worked on one project, and it was a Beat Saber level editor, which is a bit of a hobby course of mine. And like, it was cool to use 3D, but it was like a very obviously 3D, you know, building a level editor for 3D games, so of course it had to be 3D. I think the interest to me is like, how can we incorporate 3D into more? Like, we're great with that globe on sliding tape, but there's so much potential to do really cool things like that.
I'm very excited to see what you're going to come up with. And also, please do take a look at the courses that Jess has been producing. They're really incredible. There we go. I can only highly recommend them. But beyond that, if you have any other questions for Josh, you can also find him. And all the other speakers, by the way, as well. We always try to bring speakers to the Smashing Stand, where you have the membership and our books and stuff. You can ask questions directly, because we have so many here, that there's no way we're going to be able to keep them all. Well, thank you so much for being with us today, Josh. Excellent.
Thank you.